Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah, thanks for coming out tonight. I made my way from 40th and Indian School, roughly, all the way through ASU down Scottsdale Road. What a nightmare. I never have to drive that. So I was thinking, am I going to be late? Am I going to be late? And my phone kept saying, no, you're going to be 20 minutes early, but it sure didn't feel like it. You know how that goes? So thanks for coming. This obviously is a subject of interest to you. Otherwise, you wouldn't be giving me your evening this evening. What do you hope to learn out of tonight's session, that you can apply in your life, in your speaking career, or your business? Refine your story. Your story as far as your own personal brand or your organization, or is it one and the same? And
sure.
Yep.
Right. And also to be able to motivate in a better way, inspire, and impact.
Sure. Great. Thank you. Others?
How to pick a story.
How to pick a story. Excellent. We'll talk a little bit about that. What's one of the challenges, like you're sitting in front of somebody, could be a sales prospect or just an audience, and try to figure out maybe what kind of story would resonate with them?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. The great thing is we have stories from, you know, when we were wee little people that have really had a huge impact on who we are today, and we have all those other stories filled in between then and now that you can use to great effect, and I'll show you how to do that tonight. Well, I'm all about efficiency, so you'll see. That's why you see up there on the left hand the applied science and bewitchery story. I'm going to show you a couple different narrative frameworks that will make it so efficient for you to get your head around the story, get it super focused, so that when you go and tell it, you can tell it in under a minute and really own the room.
What was the same thing? To learn to tell the story.
Okay, good. Yep, definitely frameworks for that.
I volunteer at two wildly different organizations. One works with foster kids and the other works with cats and dogs. I'd like to be able to put that story of each of them out in the public wherever I'm asked to speak. I'd like to do it professionally and sound good and have them understand it and take it to heart.
Terrific. Great. Yeah.
I would like to be entertaining at the same time so I can pull people.
Entertaining.
Okay,
like entertaining, like physically?
No, I don't want to do a juggling act.
That's why I asked. Maybe you were a juggler.
But I want them to be engaged.
Yeah, okay, I'll show you how to do that. One more over here that I see, yes.
My first story would be memorable.
Yep.
And takeaway.
Yeah, the really, really powerful ones, the vivid ones. Are extraordinarily memorable, and that's the idea. You know, we all live in this day and age of just mass communication and no time at all for ourselves, it seems like. And so when you're in front of a crowd or you're sitting listening to a joker like me, you know, the last thing you can afford to be is boring. We fight this tyranny of boredom because our audience's minds check out so quickly. And that's the most beautiful thing about storytelling, where it was introduced, and last week I was in New York, and it was introduced the same way. Storytelling seems to be catching on in business. Well, actually, it's been around since the beginning of time. I mean, we are Homo sapiens, and Homo sapiens, the one unique trick, gift we have over all other beings is the ability to tell stories and to collect and pull people together through the power of story. So while organizations are just starting to catch up with it, it has been a time-tested over millennia, proven way to get people together to listen and to move them to action. But the biggest trick is, how do you tell it so you turn that boredom into excitement, something vivid, something people will not soon forget? So you ready to roll? Here we go. Monty Python fans, do you whistle along? Always look on the bright side of life. You know, they are fantastic storytellers. Always love them because every time they would sit down and tell a story, it'd be funny, it'd be quirky, it'd be weird, but you could completely relate to it depending, it didn't matter who you are. So I'm a big believer, and you want to look on the bright side of life, and we have that opportunity to do it as presenters, as storytellers. Here's the interesting thing I've learned about this. Our brain makes up about 2% of our body mass. Yet it's our most important organ that eats up 20% of our energy. So the calories we digest, the power that drives our brain, our whole bodies, it consumes 20% of it. And here's a little secret. The brain is lazy. It's a survival instinct. It doesn't want to have to think. It would just prefer to sit there on the couch and watch TV and eat potato chips because there's safety in doing that. And yet we all know that we can't go through life doing that. Our businesses, our speaking careers, our own personal brands require us to get out into the world and burn those calories on behalf of our clients or our customers or our audiences so they don't have to. And that's where story comes in. Story literally creates a picture. A vivid story imprints a picture in the theater of your mind. We are visual beings as we all sit around with our glasses on. We take in most of our stimuli through our eyes and then through our ears. But you can sit and tell a story that ignites those, both those senses, and starts literally painting a picture on the canvas of the backs of our minds that is not soon to be forgotten. So what I want you to do, we're going to start refining your story here. In your little book I gave you anywhere, I want you to write down and answer three questions for me. So the first question is, and this could be for your personal brand, it could be for your company brand, or it could be maybe you've got a big presentation coming up or an audience that you want to get in front of. I want you to answer this one question for your audience, for your customers. What is the one problem that you solve? What is the problem that you solve in their life? What's that one thing? In the branding world, you have to get really clear on what that one problem is that you solve.
You're in the speaker?
What's that?
The speaker?
Well, if you, what are you here for tonight? For speaking, for talking? So you, and do you speak in front of audiences? And when you step up in front of that audience, why are they there to listen to you? What's the one problem that you are there to help them overcome? You know, and it may be that you address two or three or four different problems, get that all the time in the branding world. I want it to boil down to one because our brains can only focus on one thing at a time. And when you can get super focused on what that one problem is, you will be much more impactful. So, you know, it could be you said foster kids.
Yes.
So maybe that audience, you know, who are you speaking to? It could be funders out there, benefactors out there, maybe kids and the supporters or whomever. Select one of those audiences and figure out why are they going to come to you and your brand? What's the one problem that they have right now that you're going to help them solve?
The problem they have.
Yes.
Oh.
It's always
so
about
much easier
them.
When I was giving them my problem.
I know. I feel your pain. That's a shift. The next question I want you to answer is, who cares? Who cares about this problem you solve? So who is your one audience? Again, in the branding world, I hear all the time, well, Park, I've got six different audiences, and they're all important, and I've got to talk to each and every one of them. Well, that may be true, and yes, you have to talk to each and every one of them, but you have to prioritize them, and you have to talk to them one at a time. So in tonight's session, I want you to think about who is that audience that, and who cares? Answer that question. You're solving the problem, and who is that individual? And that individual represents a group of individuals that are sharing and have that same problem. We're going to come back and use this in a little bit. The next question I want you to think about with them is, what do they wish for and want? This is a little bit of a mind meld. We'll cover this a little bit later, too, in more depth. What do they wish for and want? What I mean by that is emotionally, internally, what do they wish to have happen? Do they want to overcome something? Do they not want to be fearful about something? Do they want to get rid of their frustration and be optimistic? What is that emotional, internal wish that they are trying to achieve by solving this problem? And the want is the physical thing that you provide. What do they want to buy into or buy from you in order to fulfill that wish? So often we're driven by thinking that, you know, I want to buy this little widget here just because I got to have it. It's going to make me so much more productive. I just have to have it. But really, that's just kind of an external want. What do they really wish to achieve by getting that, you know, getting that object? We, as brands, personal brands or business brands, are literally in the wish-fulfilling business by helping that audience overcome a problem they have. They're going to come to you to help do that. And then finally, I want you to ask the question is, why don't they already have it? What's standing in the way of them already not having this in their life that you are going to be able to help them overcome to bridge that gap and to plug them into getting what they wish for and want. Why don't they already have it? Those four big questions. What do they want? What's the problem to solve? Who are you for? What do they wish for and want? And why don't they already have it? You got that down? And you can keep scribbling as you go. So how did I learn how to do this? Well, I've been in Phoenix. I grew up in the Seattle area, and I moved down here in 1985, and I've been here ever since. I got married, have three kids, built an ad agency here, which I ran for 20 years. I literally have been in the branding arts and the branding marketing world for now almost 35 years. And I can tell you it was a lot easier in that business when our clients own the influence of mass media. I mean, we had so many less things to think about. We had TV that they could run their ads on, radio, print, newspaper, outdoor, events, public relations, direct mail, and no Yelp. So life was a hell of a lot easier back then to advertise and market, and most people just would go, blah, they would just tell you what to think and feel and do, and then you'd, you know, we would all go and do it. The really good brands still were storytellers, but it wasn't nearly as important as it is today. Because I learned in about 2006, I saw that whole paradigm shift. The work we were doing on behalf of our clients and doing their brand story development and their advertising work just wasn't working. It wasn't working like it did before. It wasn't pulling in customers, and they were getting pissed, and I was just totally frustrated because I didn't know why. In hindsight now, I really do know why, and it goes back to technology where it has completely leveled the playing field. So, you know, that time, websites, e-commerce was really kicking in, social media just really started getting a foothold, and what changed in all that, and where you see it today, is the masses now are the media, and they own all of our brand stories. So while we were telling stories before as brands, they own it, and they're really happy to share the highs and lows with the world out there about what they like about you and what they don't like about you. And it's also completely changed how companies communicate internally to their people. Because you know what? It used to be all about the big brands, but that doesn't work anymore. You know, I mean, people really are pushing back against the man and any sort of large bureaucracy. From the leadership all the way down, and customers and clients are just saying, no, you're going to do it my way. I'm not going to have to do it your way anymore. And they're seeing that internally. So it's been a really, really powerful shift, and it's been an exciting one because you and I get to have this our own TV stations, our own radio stations, our own print production house from the palm of our hand and our digital devices and the safety and comfort of our kitchen table, and we get to be on 24/7. So you and I are all doing this, and we are all competing for eyes and ears and attention out there. Reason number one, you can't be boring. You have to figure out how can you possibly cut through that, surprise your audiences, and then deliver what they're looking for. So while this is really, really an exciting time to be alive, you kind of think about it as Moore's Law, you know, where we are able to compound our ability, almost double and tripling our capacity in every 1 to 2 years with the better technology, faster reach, farther reach, and way more noise. But here's the problem. You and I are still all walking around with our monkey brains. Literally, our limbic system, the same brain, our subconscious mind, is the same system that our ancestors trolled around the savannah on 100,000 years ago. Using it to navigate and survive the savannah is the exact same system that we are trying to use to navigate and survive the internet. So while our brains have changed, you know, at Moore's Law and compounded our ability to do that, this portion of our brain has literally evolved at the snail's pace of Darwin. So while we're feeding all this information in, we are absolutely having a hard time processing it. That's where I found this power of story, that literally an anecdote is the antidote to this madness. The storytelling animal. Jonathan Gottschall is an amazing writer. This book I came across, and I found that it is so powerful. He talks about the intersection of story structure and brain structure, and how, as he says, our brains yield helplessly to the suction of story. And it's so powerful because while we are combating and fighting through all this noise out there, what our brains, what our monkey brains are really looking for is that story structure. Something of setup, problem, resolution that we have forgotten about in our wild world of just trying to communicate information out, which we just go blah. But now this is this fundamental structure of setup, problem, resolution, which we have been using since we were, you know, in the savannah. I mean, it literally has evolved us from cavemen and cavewomen to consumers today. I want to show you this piece real quick before I show it to you right here. I learned about this in Gottschall's book. It's called the Heider-Simmel study. I want to show you this video. It came out in like 1946. They started doing this. Heider and Simmel were sociologists. They're researchers, and they were trying to understand perception and behavior change. And so what do we actually perceive as Homo sapiens, as these storytelling monkeys, and how does it impact our behavior, and what are the stories that we tell ourselves? So I want to show you the video that they actually used way back in 1946 and have been using it ever since. And when you're done with this, just over a minute long, we'll talk about what you see going on. Okay, pretty weird, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, I always get that little nervous, like, what the hell was that sort of laughter after that? So what did you see happening there?
Big triangle, maybe bullying the little triangle.
Yeah. Circle.
And what went down then?
Trying to keep them out of the box, maybe?
That's what you saw? Yeah, and then what happened?
And then he got mad because he couldn't keep him in the box, so he broke the box.
So he went berserk on him, huh? Yeah. Did several of you see that? Yeah. See a lot. Thank you. Did someone see something different? Yes.
It seemed like a loud triangle between two triangles and a circle.
It seemed like a loud triangle?
Love triangle.
Oh, a love triangle. Oh. Yeah. What happened then? Please tell.
It seemed like the big triangle was trying to entice the circle.
Uh-huh.
At first. And the small triangle somehow managed to trap the big triangle in the box when the circle escapes, and then both of them flee, and then you're left with the big triangle. It's really frustrating, just breaks the box.
Then it goes berserk, huh? All right. I've heard of those two a lot whenever I show this, because I show this everywhere I go. I go around the world presenting this course, and it's amazing. It doesn't matter what race, religion, what language you speak, you hear a lot of these same stories. Someone sees something completely different, like so far out there that you're kind of half embarrassed to tell the crowd. Yes?
I felt that the big one was being very aggressive and pushing his way on everybody else, and that they wanted to get away from him.
And then what happened?
They said he went berserk, but I hope they got away.
But you hope they got away. Well, I love showing this because I'm always amazed at the stories that come out of it. I was working with the Arizona Librarian Association a year or so ago, and I love the irony of me teaching librarians how to tell stories. I think that's just precious. Anyways, one of the librarians said, you know, she saw kids chasing butterflies with nets, trying to catch them. I've heard cat and dog fights. I've heard all kinds of things. I've heard the love triangle several times. In fact, at our office, we had a table full of about 12 executives there working through this in a half-day course. And a lady sitting right here, this middle-aged lady, I asked her what she saw. And she goes, well, she was like swooning. She says, well, I saw Romeo and Juliet. You all saw Romeo and Juliet, didn't you? She looked around the table. But unfortunately, it was pretty much all guys. And they're going like, no, I didn't see that at all. So I asked the guy sitting right next to her, what did you see happening in this Heider Simmel movie? And he said the weirdest thing. He said, I saw sperm trying to impregnate an egg. And so when I told our creative director about that, he says, oh, great, your little Rorschach video took him from Shakespeare to Porky's in one fell swoop. But what it has underscored to me is, did you see how your brain had to create a story to create meaning out of something that was completely and utterly meaningless? But your brain, you couldn't help it. You sit there. 139 out of 140 people sitting there will have made up a story. That last person will say, yeah, I just saw stuff floating around. Probably an engineer or an attorney is my guess. But it's fascinating to me because I think it underscores that if you don't intentionally tell a story, your audience is going to leave with a story you did not intend to tell. They're going to totally make something up. So think about the last time you were in a PowerPoint presentation, or heaven forbid, giving a PowerPoint presentation, and you were leading with data, charts, stats, graphs, bullet points. What do you think your audience was doing to you?
Sleeping.
Sleeping? When they weren't sleeping, they were totally making up something because it's not in context. Our brains are not wired for numbers. Even though business is all driven by numbers and we believe we have to get up there and, you know, let's show them how smart we are, how reasonable, let's, you know, lead with ration and reason. But when was the last time you were bored into buying anything? Never. What's the first syllable of numbers?
No.
Numb.
Brilliant. Sorry.
Numb. Exactly. Our brains aren't wired for it. So let's dive back, if we would. Let's go back to the savannah. We're only going to go back 30,000 years here, and I'm going to show you how this first narrative framework came to being and how it is probably more important for our survival and evolution than our opposable thumbs. So here we've got our cave mates. We've got Thog in the doorway. Thog's been out fishing. He comes back, and we've got his fairly rotund cave mate there. What's his name? I need a name for him.
Fred?
Fred Flintstone.
Yeah.
Fred. All right, Fred's sitting there, and Fred looks at Thog, and Fred says to Thog, Thog, where you been? And Thog says, well, I went down to river to catch saber-tooth salmon for dinner. And Fred goes, uh-huh. And Thog says, but saber-tooth tigers show up. Fred goes, uh-oh, what'd you do? He goes, well, I give salmon to tiger. It likes salmon better than Thog. Therefore, I'm back here at Fire Safe with you. And Fred goes, aha. Setup, problem, resolution. Story structure so primal, so simple, even a caveman can do it. So when I learned about this process, I started diving in. I thought to myself, could it really be that easy? In fact, I've had people suggest that it's reductive and insulting. But let me show you why it's not. Let me show you why it is so critical to the success of any of your communications and to get your stories and your speaking as focused as possible. Let's start moving through time here a little bit. And let's go to, there we go, Aristotle. Aristotle, in his Poetics, his book on writing poetry and playwriting and storytelling, he said, every story has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And you may be like me hearing that right now, as I was the first time I heard it. I was like, well, duh. But here's the thing I've learned. In business, in branding, in any sort of bureaucracy that is outside of your social realm, we will leave out the middle of the story. We will show up. We'll say, here's who I am and here's what I offer. It's the best in town. We'll go to the end. You want to buy some. We never take time to think about what is the conflict or the contradiction that is going on in our little tail that makes our limbic system, that subconscious that is completely wired for survival of our being, to snap to attention. That's what I want you to do, to start putting in your stories. Because where else have we seen it? Let's look at the evolution of this. So we talked about Shakespeare. He typically wrote in five acts, but you can boil them down to these three basic acts of its introduction, rising action, and climax. He introduces us to his characters. He sets the scene. He builds the relationships. Then what does he do? He pulls a rug out from underneath them. Their whole world falls apart, and we there as audience members are sitting, lapping it up, trying to figure out how are they going to get through it? How are they going to survive it, and what is the outcome? Is this a comedy or a tragedy? And then he brings it full circle, and he ends up with the climax of the story. Setup, problem, resolution. There it is again. Where else do we see it? Music. I studied music composition theory in college. Thank God I also got a degree in communication so I could actually make a living. But I was fascinated by music. I was writing songs when I was a little kid. I wrote them all the way through college, and I still write some today. It's just fun, just a hobby. When I was studying it, they told me that in one of our theory history classes, that the sonata allegro form, Mozart being one of the instigators of it, was totally based on the three-act structure of story at the time. We've got exposition, development, and resolution. He establishes a theme, he establishes a key, it might be major, minor, he brings in a couple of other themes to go along with it, and they have some fun for a while, and then he pulls the rug out from underneath you as a listener. Totally changes a key, modulates to somewhere else, he plays those themes backwards, he plays them upside down, he introduces new themes that are, you know, contrast to them, so you're sitting there as an audience and you are going on a journey. You're like, how in the hell is he going to bring all this together? And then he wraps it all together in the resolution of the piece. Setup, problem, resolution. It's the way our brains are wired to make meaning out of the madness of being human beings. Hegel, famous theorist, philosopher, you know, the creator of the dialectic that we use for modern day debate. It's all about thesis, antithesis, synthesis. I say this, you argue that, we have a conversation together, and we find a synthesis of the meaning and bring it all together. Setup, problem, resolution. There's a modern day philosopher who can attribute his entire successful career to this same idea. You might recognize him. South Park. South Park fans here? Yeah? Yeah? You know, the great thing, whenever I ask that question, I always get people to go like, yeah, kind of, you know, like, own it, man, own it. I love South Park for the reason of how unbelievably powerful and consistent and sustainable their storytelling is. Whether you like the content or not, put that aside, their story structure is unbelievable. Matt Stone and Trey Parker, I didn't know this, but there's a video online called 6 Days to Air. If there's a new South Park that is airing this Sunday on Comedy Central, they literally are producing it right now. They write them in 6 days, they conceive them, they write them, they animate them, they voice them, and Sunday morning, early afternoon, they run them over to Comedy Central, and Comedy Central puts it up that night. I mean, that's just unbelievable. And yet, it's one of the longest running TV series of all TV series, and the second longest animated series only to South Park. Or no, Simpsons, thank you. So that says they've got something going on here. Well, here's Trey Parker explaining how they do it.
South Park has been so successful over the years, not only because their episodes contain satire, but because their episodes contain proper story structure. The rule that Trey and Matt use in their writer's room is called the but therefore rule.
We can take these beats, which are basically the beats of your outline, and if the words and then belong between those beats, you're between every beat that you've written down is either the word therefore or but. Should be this happens, and therefore this happens. But this happens, therefore this happens. You get a show that feels like, okay, this to that, to this to that, but this, here's the complication, to that.
This idea of and, but, and therefore, it's a fascinating one to me. And it works unbelievably powerful. I mean, in the branding world, my job has always been to help brands take their big thinking, their big ideas, and boil it down to a nugget, a core message that then you can build all of your other messaging off. So when I was in search of trying to figure out how do we stand out in this noisy world? Our advertising branding work isn't working like it used to. What do I, you know, where do I go from here? We were fortunate because my wife and I have three kids. Our middle child, Parker, was going to film school at the time at Chapman University over in Orange County, or City of Orange, and he's graduated in 2010, and he's been in Hollywood ever since. And he's a director of virtual reality. So I asked him, I said, send me your books when you're done with them, since I'm paying for them, because I want to learn, what do they teach you to be a competitive storyteller in the most competitive storytelling market in the world, Hollywood and LA? And that's when I started finding these little nuggets. I first found Joseph Campbell in The Hero's Journey and started, you know, looking, how could we use that in the branding world to humanize a brand? And that's a whole nother session. We don't have time to talk about that today. But while I was looking for this, I was finding other people that were really brilliant storytellers from all different aspects of life. Dr. Olson, who wrote this book, Narrative is Everything, has become one of my fast friends, and this is where I first learned this technique from. Now, Olson is a Harvard-trained PhD evolutionary biologist, so he knows something about our brains and our bodies. Well, he gave up tenure, and he went to USC Film School in his mid-30s. He graduated. He produced three documentaries, wrote, directed, and produced three documentaries on climate change and global warming. But more importantly, he's written four different books to teach the science community how to do a better job of communicating their big ideas, how to use story to get more grant funding and that sort of thing. And this was his fourth book that he launched just about a month and a half ago around this idea of the and, but, and therefore. He got it from South Park. I just love the idea, the contradiction of a Harvard-trained PhD evolutionary biologist being a gigantic South Park fan. Because there it is again. It's been around since the beginning of time. It looks like this. And, literally, but, and therefore. What you do is you set the context for your message. Now, this could be a message that is about your brand. You're really trying to solidify your main brand story. Or maybe it's a message that you want to get the theme down if you're going to go in front of a presentation or whatever. This is what you want to do in your own mind to start getting this super focused. You set the context of your message, and then you raise the stakes. You make it more important for your audience. So they're going, oh, yeah, okay. But you state the problem. But here's the problem. Here's the conflict that I'm trying to help you overcome in this process, and then you've got the solution. Set up problem resolution in three acts, but you can do this in two sentences. You can do it in 40 words. And when you get this down, you practice it and you use it really well, what you are doing is you're literally hacking through the noise by talking to our limbic system brain on how it wants to receive information. Set up problem resolution. So much so that it doesn't even have to think. It doesn't have to work for it. You've burned the calories to get to this point to figure out your theme, and then you deliver it. So here's an example of it. Here's Dr. Olson. I do a podcast every Monday, a brand new podcast. It's been going for 4 years. I'm up to 230 shows now. And what I do is I bring in storytellers from around the world and interview them. So, you know, people like you, like people, leaders of brands, speakers can listen to these people to figure out how are they using story and how can I apply it in my life. Well, I've had Olson on now 4 times because he's just so interesting and I've learned so much from him. But look at how I used even the ABT up here in my Instagram post. This simple. Most executives communicate and care, but bore. Therefore, use the universal narrative structure of the ABT to excel through the stories you tell. And, but, and therefore. Statement of agreement, most executives communicate. We can all pretty much agree on that. And, raise the stakes, are often boring. Or they care, but they bore. And therefore, use this basic story structure. So when I first saw it, and like I said, people have said it's reductive and insulting, it can't possibly work. I started looking around and thought, where else has this shown up in our life? What is the true evolution of this? And I came across the Gettysburg Address. It's a fabulous example of it. So you look up here. Lincoln starts out 47 years ago, which, by the way, is just another way of saying once upon a time. Because he was a great storyteller. Our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. That's all he said. Act one is done. He set the stage. Now, most executives and most leaders would go, and this, and that, and this, and they would trip all over themselves in act one of the exposition. Your audience is like totally on board. So what does he do? But now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure, so on and so forth. Now he's squarely into act two, the conflict, the contradiction, and their storytelling brain loves this stuff. How's he wrap it up? Therefore, we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. Set up problem resolution, beautifully done. Now, did he know about the ABT back in his day? Probably not, because he wasn't following, you know, Cartman. How could he possibly have known? But there you see it. Do you realize, and I didn't know this until I started doing a lot more digging, that he wasn't even the keynote speaker at Gettysburg. He spoke in second position. Did you know that? Yeah. There was someone that went on and spoke before him. Do you know who went on before him?
No, but I've heard the story from my son. He was not the original keynote.
No. A dude by the name of Edward Everett. He was the former Secretary of State, self-proclaimed orator. Edward Everett spoke for 2 hours. Do you know how long Lincoln spoke for?
5 minutes.
2 minutes. Like 270 words. And yet it's one of the most iconic addresses ever given by any leader anywhere. Now again, he didn't know the ABT, but he was an intuitive storyteller. He just knew how to do it really well. My argument is you all are intuitive storytellers too, because you're all Homo sapiens. What I want you to do is become intentional about it using this framework, because you see it everywhere. I mean, all leaders with any sort of charisma, whether you buy into their politics or not, use this process. So we've got a reality TV show star sitting in the White House right now. What was his ABT, his total platform that got him elected in 2016? That's his therefore. What led up to it? What was his and his but leading up to it? It's the whole basis for the entire MAGA campaign. Here it is. America was once a great and mighty nation, but America is no longer great. Therefore, I'm going to make America great again. It's so basic, and yet it's so powerful. Now, I wouldn't say Trump is a particularly good storyteller, because he doesn't really tell stories. He's just a good bardsman. I mean, he just throws out lines, and he's all about conflict and contradiction. That's what drives his entire thinking. Dr. Olson was working with Hillary and the gang leading up to that, and he told them, he said, if you don't start telling better stories and get more focused, you're going to lose to this guy. And they didn't believe him. They actually ran him kind of out of D.C. So the day after the election, I called Randy up and I said, you know, I've got to get you on the show. I want to talk about Trump's narrative intuition and how this guy got elected. And he was working with NASA at the time, Randy was. He goes, I can't possibly, because I'm just too pissed off. And I said, that's exactly why I need to have you on my show. So I did. I recorded him that afternoon, and to this day, it's still my number one listened to show. It's the one show I've ever gotten hate mail on, because people, friends were saying, you know, why are you glorifying it? And I said, we're not. We're just revealing, do you understand his communication style, the power of story, and how it got him elected? The idea here is, coming out of this, I said, you know, you have to understand the magic if you're going to combat the spell, but I want to make that more opportunistic. You have to understand the magic if you're going to cast the spell. And that's what I want you to be able to do, because it literally is everywhere around us. Any Carly Rae fans? You know this video? It's got over a billion views on YouTube. Wait for it. Wait for it. There you have it. Now, is she a one-hit wonder because she has the ABT in her lyrics, in her chorus? Probably so. Did her lyricist know about the ABT? Probably not. Just really good intuitive storytelling of conflict and resolution in there. That's where I want you to become intentional about it. So I want you to try this on a story here. Let me give you kind of the academic background on it, and then I'm going to like boil it down a little bit simpler. So what you want to do is you want to make a declarative statement of agreement, because you don't ever want to come across as the expert in the room. You just want to make a statement about your theme that you can get your audience going, yeah, you know, that makes sense. And then you increase its importance. And it's important because of this. And then you go, but the problem is we're trying to overcome this, this, and this. Therefore, you resolve the problem with your answer, with your presentation, with your brand, with whatever it is that you are talking about and trying to connect with your audiences. Setup, problem, resolution. Remember this? That's all we're doing. You can really boil it down to be this quick. Set the context, raise the stakes, state the problem, and the solution. So I've got a Facebook group. It's a private Facebook group. You're more than welcome to come and join us over there, Business of Story for Purpose-Driven Leaders. And on it, I had this guy, this Eric Relea. And I've never met Eric. Eric has been a member of the group for about 2 years, and he sent me this note, and this I thought was just such a great example of how this ABT can help you use story structure to really quickly simplify the theme of your message. He says, took a stab at applying A, B, and T method. Feels a bit like I'm using circular logic. And that's what happens when you're really an expert at something, because you get that curse of the expert. You get caught up in it. So let me just read some of this to you. He starts with his ABT. There are literally millions of people, patients and non-patients alike, who are ashamed of or unhappy with their smile and not able to find an easy, painless, and affordable way to regain the life-changing confidence to smile. So really a long and statement. You're just like, what? Huh? There's a solution there. There's not a solution there. But smile transitions is easy, painless, and affordable. It fits right over your own teeth and is thin and strong with the look of natural teeth. So on and so forth. So, okay, so now, wait, where the problem is, he's already given me the solution, but then he's also talking about some other problems in there, circular logic. Therefore, smile transitions is an excellent treatment option for patients who are hesitant to commit to more involved restorative treatment. Smile transitions offers these patients the experience of living with better function and superior aesthetics. So he's sold us 3 or 4 or 5 different times in there. And you, as an audience, are just kind of sitting there going, what, huh? It's confusing. But that was his problem, because I'm too close to it. I don't quite get it. So I got this from him, and very quickly I was able to write an ABT, because I knew where he was going with this. And this is what I sent him back. Nothing lights up a room like a beautiful smile. And millions of people wish they could enhance their teeth. But they think it's difficult, painful, and expensive. Therefore, smile transitions is the fastest, most affordable way to restore your pearly whites and brighten your confidence. We have emotion in it. It's more fun. We have an absolute setup. I make a statement of agreement. Nothing lights up a room like a beautiful smile. Most people are going to go, yeah, you're exactly right. And, oh, by the way, millions of people wish they could enhance their teeth. Yep. You know, me too. But they think it's difficult, painful, and expensive, and therefore smile transitions. Yes, you had a question.
Yeah, I have a question. How critical is it that the words are exact? So, for example, could you replace therefore with however?
Yep. Actually, however would be in the but. Okay. So this and this, however, here's the problem. But yeah, you can use other words. What we're trying to do here and what we found works is it gets your brain thinking instead of, it's narrative intuition. It's what Trump has really good. He knows how to set it up and then throw the punch, and then, you know, he's got some answer for it. It is extraordinarily powerful, so you can use other words. I like to use the ABT because it just makes me think, you know, there. Now when I'm writing, if I get too many buts in there and it like feels like it's too redundant, then I'll start switching it out with some other things. What you will probably feel like is that it seems like it's too staid. It's like too obvious. People are going to know what you're doing. Nobody knows because they have no idea what you're doing to them because they don't know this. They don't know this. But it is triggering that subconscious limbic system saying, oh, there's a problem going on here. in business development, I found this to be an unbelievably powerful tool. You got to practice it. You got to really work on it and use it every day. Use it in emails. Use it in anything you're writing. Sit down and go, what am I trying to communicate here? Write your ABT out and then do the rest of your communication. But I found in business, if I'm sitting across from a company that needs help with something or somebody does, they will quite often sit there, and I'm sure you've all have had this experience where they just give you a brain dump, and it's like 10 minutes. You feel like they're psychologists because they're just like, ah, but their frustration's coming out, their fear's coming out, and all that. You're hearing that. You take notes, you listen very carefully, and then you repeat back what you just heard from them in the ABT. So their 10 minutes turns into about 20 seconds. And they will sit there and they will go, oh my God, you said that better than I did. You understand it better than I do. You actually listen. Thank you. Nobody listens to me anymore. If you don't get the ABT exactly right, which sometimes you won't, you've also done them a favor because they will stop you and say, oh, no, you missed one part. I forgot to tell you about this. So it helps clarify their position and their problem. But I'm telling you, this is the bewitchery of story because they will look at you like you are some sort of Merlin. You're like, how in the hell did you do that? And you're just using the same practice that we used way back in the Savannah of setup, problem, resolution. Yes, sir.
What do you do when you have characters and when you have dialogues?
We'll talk about that briefly next. So you can use the ABT in that too. I want you to practice this right now because it gets your brain in the setup problem resolution. And then I'll talk about that with the sheets you've got there, the five primal elements of story, of how once you set your theme in 20 seconds or less with your ABT, how you would share then an example story. For example, let me tell you about. And then you tell them in a very quick little small anecdotal story that will have tremendous impact. And at that point, they will like totally understand what the problem is. You will have illustrated it through an example of how you helped somebody through that or whatever. And they're like, wow, that was cool. You know, can you help me? Or do you have another example of it? But I want you to start with this because it really gets you thinking in the setup problem resolution. He writes back, wow, thank you. Now I get it. And me being the smart ass I am, I had to write one more ABT. It says, finding your theme is often like pulling teeth, painful, and messy. But I found the ABT to be the smile transitions of branding. Therefore, story on. But you can see how you can take a thought, and you can take a big thought, you can take a really complex thought and boil it down to this basic structure of and button, therefore. What your brain will do is it'll look at you and it'll say, this is too easy, it can't work, make it more complicated, 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 show them how smart you are. And I want you to resist that. I want you to put that and up there, that but up there, that therefore up there, and be as complete and simple as you possibly can be, because in that simplicity is the clarity. Then once you bring some more stories into it, you can have some more fun with it. So I want to get back to this concept before I have you kind of think through an ABT, and I'll have you write one or two down and we can kind of work on them together here. I want to go back to this idea of wish and want because it's really, really important. So you want to understand your audience and empathize with them so much that you know what they are wishing for. What do they actually wish emotionally to happen in their life by listening to or working with you? In my case, I love Apple computers. You know, this is just a commodity like anything else, but I'll pay extra for it, always have. I think it works well. I think it really helps fulfill my wish of what they're all about, thinking different, being disruptive, being creative, and going out and pushing it back against the PC world. It's just in my nature, it's what I've always done. So that's my wish. I wish to have something that reflects who I believe the person I am, you know. So what do I want? I want the product. I want to buy that. I want to buy the anything they've got. I do have the watch, but I don't wear it anymore because the damn thing kept going off at the weirdest time. So, and then the question is, what story will you tell that triggers their will to act? So what are the stories and how can you get in front of them using the ABT and these other stories that they go, oh, you're just like me. You've got a solution for me. What do I need to do next is what they're going to ask. That's where the wish, want, and will comes from. So here's a way to look at this. So I've expanded the ABT here a little bit to work in this wish, want, and will into it. It's a little more complex than the very first one I showed you. So you can do it this way, or you can work off the one on your sheet. But let me show you an example of this, of how I've used it. And I use a lot of different ABTs depending on who I'm talking to or whatever. But this is kind of a general universal one for my work now in teaching story, in storytelling, in business and branding. So we are four leaders of purpose-driven brands. In answer to question number two, who cares? Who are you for? Leaders of purpose-driven brands who wish to leverage their passion. They're in business because they want to make a bigger impact that reflects who they are and want to make a significant impact in the communities they serve. But their problem is they're frustrated by a muddled brand story. I hear this all the time. Park, we've been in business. We've got a great business model going. We're serving lots of people. But competition's starting to show up and we're not differentiated in the market. I'm hiring 5 to 10 new people every month and I realize we don't have a story that they can all align with and pull together. So our efficiency is just going to crap. And then finally they'll say, I was in my banker or my VC last week and I was embarrassed when they asked me, what's your story? And I realized I didn't have one. So they're super frustrated. They know they're muddled and they're just looking for a relief. Therefore, the answer is the business of story guides you through the proven story cycle system to clarify your story, amplify your impact, simplify your life, growing organizations by as much as 600%. So I've used my little buoys there. I call them the and button, therefore buoys. Think of yourself coming into a foggy harbor and you're trying to dock your boat. You know, you're looking for that first and buoy to get you to come in. Then the butt buoy to help deliver you to the shore, then you actually land your boat on the therefore. It's just taking the brain through this process. Now, there's my audience. Here's what they wish for. Here's what they want. Here's the problem, and it's about frustration that they want to overcome. Therefore, this is the one and only very basic time that I talk about what my offering is, what my product actually is or service is, because you know what? The audience doesn't care. They just want to know that you can help them and have some proven way of doing it. So you want to really be able to understand what's driving them up top. And then you got to, you know, talk about the outcomes. So I help them clarify their story to amplify their impact, simplify their life, and then how in the world do you measure this? Well, I've got a client right here in Adelante Healthcare, Naveen Tafoya, who we did this with back in 2010. And she told me 2 months ago that in that time, since they've clarified their story, that organization has grown by 600% because you got everybody pulling in the same direction, doing their thing. Does it make sense? I know I'm throwing a lot at you. We don't have a lot of time, but I want you to think about this, and you can either work from this form or work with that little handout that I gave you there. And why don't you take 2 or 3 minutes and write an ABT. Write one, something that relates to you, to your business, to a speech you're going to be giving, or to a message that has been confusing or kind of cluttered in your mind, and see if you can't unclutter it using this simple little technique. Any questions on that?
Can I just go back to the wish, want, will?
Yep.
When you were using your Apple Mac example?
Oh, the way back.
Yeah, sorry.
You mean this one?
Yeah, so you had like your wish.
Yep.
Of like what Apple represents.
Yep.
And you spoke about your want, the Apple Mac.
The product.
The will? Yes.
The will is what stories do you tell to trigger the will to act, to actually get your customer to buy.
So the trigger.
Yeah. So they wish emotionally. What do emotionally they want to get by working with you? What do they then want, you know, in what you have to offer? And what stories will you tell them to trigger that will to act? It all starts, though, by really simplifying that story through the and button, therefore. All right, how'd you do out there?
It's hard.
It's hard at first. It is. It is. But, you know, I call this my storytelling dumbbell because the more you do it every single day and emails and everything, you will get really good at it. And you will be amazed at how quickly it'll help you really define your stories, your theme, and so forth. It's just that powerful. Just keep curling it every day. Does someone have one you'd like to share? Right here? Then we'll work around there. All right. Look at this. Thanks for standing. I love a guy that owns the room. This is awesome. All right, let's hear it.
Some people are fearful to speak in public.
Mm-hmm.
And they lose opportunities that might help them in growing their business or their careers. But it is difficult for them to accept the power of public speaking. If they have a simple process that they can easily learn, their speaking, their business or their career will grow daily from 100 to 1,000% because they will feel confident with the process and will lose the fear of public speaking.
That's great. Are you a public speaking coach?
I am getting there.
You're getting there. Now, what'd you think of it?
Yeah.
It was good. I mean, it really clarified it, didn't it? Did it seem too easy to you? Did it seem like it was too basic? Because I hear that, but I mean, how did that resonate with you?
Very well.
Have you ever?
The thing is, I'm doing a presentation to college students.
Yeah.
Precisely on the fear of public speaking.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been thinking about, so this gives me the solution.
So you can start. Okay, so, and you had asked about when and where do I find my stories and what. So here's a really good example. What, do you have a presentation coming up next week or soon?
No, it's in January.
Okay. And it's for students, right, entrepreneurs and so forth.
Right.
So you could start your entire presentation with that
right
there. You know, refine it, fine tune it. And then you say, you just give them the ABT and you say, for example. And then you share a story, maybe about yourself, something you learned about public speaking. You were fearful of it, and you overcame it, whatever. And here's what you want to do in that story, and that's that other sheet that you've got there. This is called the five primal elements of story. Once I tell them to you, you're going, well, I already do this when I'm sitting, you know, across from somebody. You do, again, because you're an intuitive storyteller. I want you to become intentional about it. So you're going to find an example in your life, and ideally, if it was an example about you, were you ever really afraid of telling a story, of getting on stage?
Yeah.
Yeah? Can you take us to a moment that you remember that you were absolutely petrified in telling a story or speaking on stage?
Oh, right now.
Yeah. Yeah. Take us to your very first time you had to get up in front of an audience and you were petrified.
I was a treasurer for an association. I was in college and I had to give the report of the financial report.
Mm-hmm.
And I was shaking like this all the time. And I didn't complete the sentences at all. So it was a difficult process.
What did you learn? What has transpired to take you from that time to where you are today?
Well, right now I'm better prepared. That's mm-hmm. definitely what has helped me. I memorize my speeches
mm-hmm.
and I get prepared. You know, my speeches I practice 10 times or more daily.
So is preparation kind of a secret weapon?
Right.
That's like job number one if you're going to get up? Were you not prepared the very first time when you got up? Okay. Wonderful example here. So he can get up then in front of the whole audience, and he says, when I was in college. That's a time stamp. Even though, you know, we don't have an actual date or time on it, looking at him, it was a few years ago.
Yeah. Already
been invented. There you go. Timestamp. You want to have a timestamp to start your story. When did whatever you're about ready to tell them happen? When you do that, you hack through into the subconscious, and the subconscious goes, oh, you're just about ready to tell me a story. I better pay attention to it because something must go down that I want to know.
Right.
Then you have a location stamp. So yours is kind of the same, in college, whatever. But you said you were part of a treasury club?
Yeah.
No, treasury club.
It was an association. I was a treasurer.
Association. Treasurer of an association. And you might even say where that university was or whatever. It helps the brain really set the stage that something happened. And then I got up, and I was so fearful. I was trying to read from my notes, and it was shaking as hard as they could possibly shake, so much so I couldn't even read them. When I was all said and done, it was the worst time in my life. And you might be asking yourself, well, then why are you here coaching me on how to be a public speaker, right? Because you got conflict, you got contradiction going there. What I learned from that very one moment many decades ago is preparation. I had my notes, but I wasn't prepared. And therefore, I shook. And so today, the first thing I'm going to teach you is about preparation. And if you're prepared, you have the confidence to be able to get up and own any room, let's begin. So what he's done there, you've got a time stamp, you have a location stamp, you have a central character. One character. In this case, it was him. I'm sorry, your name?
Antonio.
Antonio. The central character in the story is Antonio. Quite often, your best stories are going to be you as the central character because you're going to take us on a learning journey. Then there's got to be action. Oh, my God, the action is I got up and I had to talk. And I was shaking so hard and I was sweating and I couldn't even barely read the paper. And then there's got to be surprise in that action. Like, the surprise in this case is the aha moment, really, of I realize that it's preparation. That it's always about having the confidence of being extraordinarily prepared. So from that day forward, every time I ever had to give a piece, now I'm just, making this part up, this is total fiction or not, that I went out of my way to prepare through memorization. And now I memorize everything, and that's the first thing I'm going to teach you today. And then, boom. Now, he's into that presentation 3 minutes tops, maybe even 2 minutes. His ABT comes out of him in about 20 seconds, and he can tell that story there, depending on how much you embellish it and make it interesting for him. Could be a minute, maybe 2 minutes, but by 3 minute mark, they are totally listening to you. They're totally in, and you've got all this credibility because you're being vulnerable and you're telling them a story about what happened to you. Time stamp, location stamp. When did this happen? Where did this happen? Who's the central character that your audience can relate to? What happened? There has to be action. And then typically a surprise out of that action. I got up to speed and I was shaking so hard I couldn't even read it, And then there's the aha moment. There's the business point that you're trying to make. What I learned from that one instance is preparation is everything. If you're not prepared, you don't have the confidence to perform. Yeah. All right. Thank you. Do you see how that works? You take your ABT to set the stage and get your theme down, and then you back it up with a story. Now, did you want to share yours?
I'm following that.
Yes?
I did one, but I did it based on a Brandon statement.
Cool, let's hear it.
Do I have to get up like so?
Hell yeah, get on up here.
Well, my shoes are disintegrating, which is really interesting, so everywhere I go, I'm leaving something. Therefore, people will remember me.
Exactly right. And your name?
Stephanie.
Stephanie, all right, Stephanie.
Employers are frustrated by the constant revolving doors of employees, and they don't want to deal with the problem because it seems insurmountable and expensive. Therefore, we are there to help them create a positive workplace by developing cultures of traction, not transaction.
Traction, not transaction. That's nice.
That's a trademark of mine.
Well, there you go. Okay, can you read it again for us?
Yeah, but I didn't bring my glasses, so here, could you hold this up? Just kidding. Employers are frustrated by the constant revolving door of employees, and they don't want to deal with the problem because it seems insurmountable and expensive. Therefore, we are there to help them to create a positive workplace by developing a culture of traction, not transaction.
Okay. So, good. Really good job. I'm wondering if we could make it more powerful.
Please.
And another point in this is you really want contrast between your and your but statement as much as possible. So right now, she starts with the problem and then amplifies the problem, which works really well. What if you had, what they really wish for? So, attracting and retaining top talent is job number one for the success and survival of any company. But we currently have more turnover now than ever in this fast-paced world we live in, and it's really hard to deal with as a business owner. Therefore, we provide the assistance and whatever. So you're saying, yeah, I want this up here. I mean, retaining top talent is absolutely critical, but we ain't doing it because we don't have the right systems in place. Oh, therefore, you happen to have the right systems.
It's funny because I always talk about how we help attract, train, and retain employees.
Yeah.
But,
I was just looking at some of those statistics the other day, and they don't completely resonate in my brain right now, but it's something 48% of people are happy with their jobs, under half.
Yeah.
It might even be worse than that. And that retention, you're lucky to keep a good employee for 2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what I would like you to do is see if you can't get more contrast in your and statement up top and your but statement so that you're going, oh my God, there's a huge problem here. There's a huge gap here. Oh, you can you know, help me with that.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Yours was good. I think it could just be stronger by finding that contrast.
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah. And then, by the way, if you're sitting down from a prospect and you share the ABT, then the very thing is, and try this. So the next time, do you have a pitch coming up in the next week or two?
Yeah, always, in written form.
So, in written form, if you can get across from somebody, really dial in your ABT, share it with them, and see if you can't actually see their bodies kind of lean into you. It'll be imperceptible to them, but it's like their brain's going, yes, tell me more. And then you go, for instance, and then have a story in your back pocket. Someone you've worked with, someone that's going through the same thing that they're going through, time stamp, when did it happen? Location stamp, where did it happen? If you can't say the company or the executive, you can say, you know, for confidentiality reasons, let's just call it AYZ, you know, whatever, and we'll call my CEO, Mary, you know, who I was working with. That's totally fine to do. People will respect that. But you want to attach a name to them or whatever, and here's what they were going through. And they had the aha moment when they hired us, and we realized that they thought the problem was here. The problem was actually over here. We went in, focused our attention, and they all of a sudden turned their attention around, you know, by 10% or something like that. But have that little, quick little case study in your back pocket, time stamp, location stamp, character, action, surprise, and aha. How's it, what, you know, what's the business point you're making in that? Those are the stories you want to find and have them in your back pocket. I use Evernote, and I won't even write out the entire story, because quite often you're sharing these stories orally. So you say, that time when? And then I'll just say, you know, when I was working with the Air Force and Sergeant Sheridan said, and then it triggers my mind and said, oh, I know what that story is. If I don't remember all the details, then I'll just kind of quickly just outline the time stamp, location stamp, you know, that sort of thing. And then I'll tag them. So is this a story about innovation? Is it a story about leadership? Is it a story about branding? I'll have my whole list of different tags. So when I need to have a story at the ready, and I've got in my vault now a couple hundred of them, I go in and say, I need a story on innovation. And then boom, 10 stories of innovation. I can go through and go, oh, you know, this one would be perfect. And then I plug them in that way. So that's where you start, and you look for stories that back up and make the business point that you're trying to make, and then find a really easy way to catalog them for you so that they're easily accessible when you need them. And, you know, sales and a presentation and a speech or whatever. All right, that help?
Yeah.
Did you have one in the back?
I did.
Let's hear it. And your name?
My name's Connie.
Connie. All right, Connie. Come on up, Connie.
Mine is also business related.
Perfect.
NCU is for busy working professionals who want to advance in their careers through education, but they don't think they have the time or money. Therefore, NCU offers a convenient, flexible, and affordable PH program that will help them achieve the future they envision.
Okay, so let's do it again. Say it, go ahead and just say it a little slower out loud and get the flow to it.
Okay, NCU is for busy working professionals who want to advance in their career through education, but don't think they have the time, money to do so. Therefore, NCU offers a convenient, flexible, and affordable PhD program that will help them achieve the future they envision.
Okay, so you did a little bit, good job. You did a little bit like smile transition. You were offering the close at the very beginning. So you must have a statistic somewhere or whatever saying, you know, today's modern executive is always looking to get ahead through continuing education for themselves, but they don't feel they have the time and the energy and the money to do it. Therefore, ANC?
NCU.
NCU offers da-da-da-da-da. So you don't introduce your solution till the very end. Okay. You see what I'm saying? But set up the problem or set by saying, here's what you can achieve up top, you know. More and more executives are doing this, and it's important for their career growth, but they don't feel like they have the time and the money to do it. Therefore, we are specifically designed to help them get there. Yeah, try it that way.
Okay.
Yeah, I think, I know, I'm sorry, we got a little bit late here. I'll let you go. Any other questions? Do you see how that can work for you? And you, there's a worksheet back here, too, so it's a time stamp, a location stamp, a central character, that your audience can relate to. Action and surprise, action slash surprise. There's got to have something that happens and sort of a surprise outcome of that. And then the aha moment. What does this story say about you, about your business point, or about, you know, what you're trying to say?
I have issues with the therefore part. I wrote two little things, and both of them, when I get to therefore, I don't know what I'm therefore-ing.
What's the problem you're solving for?
Okay, one is that, the first one is, too many cats and dogs are euthanized in Maricopa County every year. And this doesn't need to continue, but people continue to buy puppies and kitties from puppy mills rather than just adopting them from the pound, and they don't have them spayed and neutered.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore...
So what does your organization do?
We rescue dogs and cats from the street. It's a no-kill shelter. Therefore, mm-hmm. they need to... I don't know, be brave enough to adopt a dog, realize what a companion adopting a dog or a cat is, what a good feeling it is.
Yeah. So it sounds like the solution, the answer is in the adoption of a dog. In your mind, in your world.
Yeah. How would I phrase that?
I don't know. But you'll get there. Therefore, reach out to us and we will help you adopt, you know. You know, maybe it's, you know, we're having people are buying dogs and cats or breeding dogs and cats all the time, and it's becoming a real problem, but they don't really understand how powerful adoption can be and as an option. Therefore, we are here to help them, connect them with just the right dog, you know, cat that they can love.
Thank you. Okay, because that will follow over into the one I did on adoption, too.
Yeah.
Now I have an answer,
yeah.
Therefore.
There you go. Simplify. Just keep trying to simplify. Yes, sir.
When you said a template, were you talking about this?
That's the ABT. And then there's also one back there if you didn't get one on the five elements of story. So this would be what you would use for the theme. And then there's another workshop or worksheet there. Yeah, I think there's still a couple back there. All right, I'll leave you with this. This is the overall where you use the AND button there for Act 1, Act 2, Act 3, how it's set up to make your theme. Then you share an example story, an anecdote of when, where, who, what, and aha. This is that time stamp, location stamp, character, action, and then the aha moment. And the story cycle is something much bigger that we use for overall presentation, creation, and branding, and so forth. But today, I really just want you to leave with this idea about using the ABT in everything. The more you use that, the more you will be able to become a very intuitive storyteller. And finally, I want you to remember that the most potent story... Oh. Well, I'll tell you what, I will send out that slide, and if you have everyone's email, you can share that with them. Yeah. So the idea here is the most potent story you will ever tell is the story you tell yourself, so make sure you make it a great one. Thanks so much for having me. All right. Sorry we ran a little long. Oh.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. That's very nice.